Good evening, everybody. Welcome. Just waiting for everyone to join. Good evening to those of you who are just joining us. We'll just give it a minute. Hello, folks who are just joining us. Welcome. I think we've got about half of you in now. Everyone's coming in. Hi, Janet. Hi, Liz. People are saying hi as they're coming in.
Evening.
Good evening. Hi, Alan. Great. Welcome, everyone who's just joined us. We'll just give it another few seconds. Got people still joining us. Okay, well, I think we're safe to make a start. Well, good evening, everybody, and a very warm welcome to the online Naturetrek Roadshow. This is the fifth presentation evening that we've run so far, having already covered South America, wildlife cruises, Eastern Europe, and Asia. Now, if you missed any of those, don't worry, we do have recordings available, so do just drop us an email at the office, and we'll be very happy to fire over a link to you so you can catch up on it. For those of you joining for the first time, my name's Sarah Frost. I'm Naturetrek's marketing manager and a cruises tour leader. And I've worked for Naturetrek for 6 years now, and I'll be your host this evening, talking to you from Hampshire. Now, as many of you know, we'd normally be out on the roads this winter presenting live in venues across the UK, talking to you in person, but we're delighted to be able to bring this online for you. We hope we don't have any technical issues. If we do, please just bear with us. You've all been very kind so far, so we'll keep our fingers crossed. And this is still new for us, but a benefit to us doing this online, of course, and so many of you have actually been emailing into us, is that we're able to reach far more of you who would not normally be able to come and join our venue presentations in person. So we can only go to a finite number of cities across the UK. So a particularly warm welcome to those of you who haven't met us before in person and are joining us tonight. So thank you very much. And we've got a lot of people joining tonight again. We've got exactly 300 households signed up for this evening. So we could guesstimate perhaps we've got, again, 400 or 500 people actually watching us. And I hope you're sitting comfortably and are joining us with a glass of wine or a beer. If not, you do have a minute to pop and get one, so you do have time. If you're not on our mailing list and you'd like to receive our brochure after watching tonight's talks, then please just email us at info@naturetrek.co.uk and we'll be very happy to pop one in the post to you. And in fact, our 2021 and 2022 brochure is being published right now as we speak and will be landing on doorsteps, probably with quite an audible thud, it's not small, in the next week or so. If you don't get one, please just drop us an email and we'll be very happy to pop one in the post to you. Likewise, our website is a fantastic resource of information. Do go on there and have an explore. There's lots of information about our tours, detailed tour itineraries that you can download, and also tour reports of previous holidays. So I really recommend going and having a look on there. Now, up until now, we've focused on relatively long haul and exotic countries. And although we're very passionate about them, and the wonderful destinations on our home continent in Western Europe are actually our bread and butter. So it's great to be focusing on that for the first time in this series, where we can celebrate the wonderful mammals and birds and plants and scenery of the countries on our doorstep. Now, for those of you who joined us on Tuesday for our Asia evening, you'll have heard me explain that we operated almost exclusively in the Himalaya from when we started in 1986. But up until 1991, when the first Gulf War started, we had to change tack and start operating in Europe, and we stopped operating in Asia for some time. And we launched a whole new portfolio of tours, starting with the Pyrenees and the Alps, and the rest is history. So we've operated there for a very long time. If you'd like to read more about how it all started, then I'd encourage you to Google Naturetrek history, and you'll find a page on our website where you can enjoy quite an amusing read about what travel used to be like back in the 1980s. Now, we want this session to be interactive, so if you do have a question, please just use the Q&A section at the bottom of your screen, where you can ask us any questions that you may have, be it questions about the tour or a destination that we're talking about, or even questions about how the travel industry is handling the pandemic as a whole. We're more than happy to answer any questions that you may have. And we'll do a full question and answer session at the end of the evening at 9:05 after the last presentation has finished, but we will try and type replies to you as well throughout the evening. Please also feel welcome to use the chat section. And this is an opportunity to chat to your fellow nature trekkers, ask people questions. And we've had a couple of people meet, as it were, people that are booked on the same tours while we've been doing these presentations and been able to swap contact details and things. So that's really nice. So do feel welcome to use that. For any people new to Zoom, don't worry, we can't see or hear you. It's just the panelists that are in the spotlight. And that's all from me. So without any further ado, we're going to kick off our Western Europe evening, and I'll hand you over to Kerrie, who's going to introduce herself and take us over to Switzerland. Over to you, Kerrie.
Thanks so much, Sarah. It's an absolute pleasure to be here this evening. I'm just going to fire up my talk to begin with. So let me do that now, and then I'll just say a few words about myself and where I'm going to be taking you to tonight. Does that look okay to you, Sarah?
Yeah, that's perfect.
Brilliant. So, I said, my name's Kerrie Porteous. I'm one of the operations managers at Naturetrek, and I started working for Naturetrek back in 2012. Over the years, I have gathered more tours that I look after. So my day-to-day job is organising and running tours sort of all over the world, but I seem to have acquired countries that mostly run down the middle of the world. It's like I don't like jet lag or something. So I look after tours to Sweden, to Switzerland, to like Austria, Croatia, moving a bit further south, we go to the Gambia, Ethiopia. Madagascar is a big one of mine to look after. I don't stray too far east or west. There's just the odd one out there, like Mexico and Indonesia, to keep all my colleagues on their toes. I've also done quite a lot of tour leading during my time at Naturetrek, a lot more in the early days when I was young, free and single. Now I've got young family at home and more responsibility in the office. So it's a bit more of a rare treat for me to get out tour leading, but I do try and get out whenever I can. And I've been lucky enough to lead or co-lead tour destinations that I'm talking about tonight. I'm going to kick off with what is probably my favorite destination in the world, and that says quite a lot. There's a couple up there, but for me, the Swiss Alps really is just one of the best places that you can visit, and particularly in the springtime. It's the first place I intend to go back to when COVID allows. I'm going to be up there in the mountains, perhaps this summer, I hope so, and exploring and enjoying the alpine botany. And that's where I'm going to take you to first this evening. I'm then going to go straight on to talking about Slovenia, slightly less known country in Western Europe, before we have our short break. So let's kick off with the highlights of the Swiss Alps. And I'm just going to start by showing you a map of the destinations that we visit at the moment in Switzerland. So we're going to start off in Wengen and the Lauterbrunnen Valley, which I hope you can see my cursor is just here. We're then going to go all the way east over to Pontresina and the Upper Engadine Valley, quite close to the border of Italy over here. And then we'll pop back to Bettmeralp, just over the mountains really from Wengen, and finish off there in Valais. Now, Wengen is our original Swiss Alps tour, and it's the epitome of chocolate box Switzerland, really. Stunning valleys, stunning mountain scenery, lovely little villages, and very efficient railway system. So we fly into Zurich for this tour, and then we take three changes to get over to our base in Wengen. That sounds a bit daunting when you think you've got your suitcase to take with you, but it's really not. We're not talking about travelling on British railways here. This is Switzerland, so you can watch the clock tick up to on the hour, and your train pulls away. The timings are all set up so that you can hop off one train, cross the platform, hop onto the next one. So it is straightforward. And our tour leader, David Tattersfield, has been leading these tours for, I don't know, 20 years or so. So as well as knowing the location of every single plant on every single mountain, he's got the train system nailed as well. Our transport for the week is brilliant. Vengen is a car-free town, except for the odd electric vehicle. So we have Jungfrau passes, and they allow us onto all the local trains, the old cable car, I think maybe one or so bus, but we're using the public transport the whole week. So you're just hopping on and off these lovely little cogwheel mountain railways. And that's how we get around each day. Because you've got that pass, it does give you the freedom to do something slightly different to the group if you want to. If you want to just take it slightly easier one day and make your way back down by train rather than doing a longer walk, then you can do that if you're having a bit of a tired day. There's definitely some freedom in there as well. And we stay in a really lovely hotel. It's called the Hotel Berghaus. It's run by the same family ever since we've been going. And that is probably, again, something like 20 years, definitely predates my existence at Naturetrek. And we're looked after really, really well by them. For example, we had some clients a couple of years ago, one poor chap broke his tooth at the airport on the way out to this holiday. By the time he got to Lauterbrunnen, the station before Vengen, our host Martina had already organised a dentist to be ready in Lauterbrunnen, tooth fixed, next train to Vengen, he carried on with his holiday. They're just efficient like that in Switzerland. And this is our backdrop for the week. It is stunning. So these are the impressive three peaks of the Eiger, the Munch and the Jungfrau. That's looking at the screen from left to right. So the Jungfrau is the young girl. The Munch is the monk, and he's protecting her, the Jungfrau, from the mighty Eiger, the ogre on the left. So this picture is actually taken from Muren, which is sort of obliquely across the valley from where we're staying in Vengen. Now, Muren is the base for our Go Slow in the Swiss Alps tour, which I'm not going to talk about specifically this evening. I'm just going to make mention of it now. But it's very much based in the same area. We visit quite a few of the same sites. So the flowers I'm going to show you shortly, many, not all, but many of them you would also see on the Go Slow tour. And it's just been designed with even more flexibility built in, shorter walks, more options to opt out during the day. And another lovely hotel, lovely base, fantastic scenery at all times. And a picnic fondue, in fact, on one day for anyone that is into their Swiss cheese, which I certainly am. And as we go around, the botany is just wonderful. So this is on the Mannlichen Mountain above Vengen. We've traveled it by cable car. And you can just see in the turf here, it's absolutely filled with gentians and primulas, ranunculus. You've got the north face of the Eiger there staring over you. It's just magical. So we are likely to see lots of these lovely gentians. These are trumpet gentians, lots of spring gentians as well. We time our tours to be in the second half of June, which is a really good time to visit. Depending on the season, it can be a little colder still. It could get really hot by this point. We never know exactly what will be out and which will be the best week to go. But the second 2 weeks of June have been reliably great for as long as we've been going. And because you're botanizing at a range of altitudes, it doesn't really matter if it's still really snowy high up. We can go further down the mountain and there'll be different and always interesting things to see. So a few more examples of what we'll be looking for. So the top left is a narcissus flowered anemone, alpine toad flax there on the top right. Lots of lovely alpine passiflowers coming out recently after the snow has melted away. And then just meadows filled with the troleus, these yellow globe flowers, just like little balls of sunlight as you're wandering your way down the mountain paths. Lots of primulas too. So these primroses, so this is Primula farinosa on the left, bird's eye primrose, and Primula auricula, the bear's ear primrose on the right. And then there's some really special flowers that we'll be looking for as well. So one day we'll go a bit higher up. We'll take the train up to the Eiger Gletscher station, the base of the glacier. And there up in the rocks here, we'll find this little viola, Viola sinensia. This is another star of the trip. This is Aquilegia alpina, the alpine columbine. And then the beautiful lady slipper orchid. We've got a site for this where we will venture sort of off the path a bit over the hillside. And if you time it well, you will have thousands of these beautiful orchids the whole way up the mountainside. Absolutely spectacular. The walking, I would say, is quite variable. We use our passes and we use the transport system to go up each day. So you're not hiking up mountains really ever. The walks are then undulating or downhill. This image is one of the tougher ones that we do. So this is coming down from that Eiger Gletscher station that I mentioned. And we're basically walking down the moraine here. So walking poles are useful. Walking poles for anyone with slightly dodgy knees are useful on all days, really. Just they take the pressure off as you're going downhill. But we take our time. We don't rush around when we're botanizing. There's no need to do that. We tend to take it very easy in the morning. We don't cover that much distance at all, to be honest, because we're looking at all the new flowers, identifying everything, taking some nice photographs. And then normally after lunch, we'll do a bit more of a walk just to get ourselves back to base. In terms of the weather, well, it's the mountains, so who knows what will happen. It's a pretty dry area, so you should expect a decent amount of sunshine. And the week that I went, which is when this photo was taken, we had almost wall-to-wall sunshine the entire week. When we arrived at the top of the station, it was brilliantly sunny. It's the mountains, so it can cloud over quickly, so you should be prepared for that and have everything that you might need in your rucksack. So as we walked down here, it got darker and darker. It started hailing, and then by the time we got to the cafe at the bottom when we're eating our apricot tart, it was brilliantly sunny again. So you just need to be organized and prepared for whatever the mountains may throw at you. And of course, we have some lovely picnic stops each day. So we'll split up the picnics, take that with us, and find a lovely location to stop. This is a particularly good one. David, our tour leader, has trained up a couple of nutcrackers in this area. They're really clever birds. I think they can remember the location of something like 20 to 30,000 seeds that they've stashed over a winter. I think they've even been seen to pretend to cache a seed and then move it later on to confuse potential thieves. But the nutcrackers here know that if a nature trek group turns up, then they are likely to get thrown a chunk of Gruyere or two. So they'll hang out and come and snatch that Gruyere and give us a nice view. So moving over to the other side of Switzerland, Pontresina became the base for our second holiday in Switzerland. And here it's quite a different geology and we're at much higher altitude. So it makes for some really different and interesting alpines. Quite a lot of people will do our two trips to Wengen and Pontresina back to back. So if you book the second week of one and the first week of the next, you can make your way by train from one straight onto the other. And that makes a really nice 2 weeks in Switzerland. That's an option. Pontresina is in Graubünden, which is the only trilingual canton in Switzerland. So here they speak German, Italian and Romansh, which are all official languages. It makes it quite confusing. However, do not worry, the efficient Swiss all speak English as well. So we're in good hands. The building here right in the middle is our hotel, the Hotel Palu. It's probably a bit bigger than, actually it's bigger than when we first started going because they have extended a bit, but it's really lovely. They take really good care of us still, good food, good location. We've been very happy there for many years. And again, we are absolutely spoilt by the transport for the week. The journey from Zurich, again with three changes, is just amazing, an absolute highlight. You go on some beautiful routes and bridges and the scenery is amazing. And then when you get there, you're on the UNESCO Heritage Bernina Express line. So there's these incredible loops and tunnels. And again, we're just hopping on and off the trains, the odd bus, the odd cable car for the week, getting ourselves around. So there's some different flora in the Upper Engadine Valley that we wouldn't have seen in Wengen. Edelweiss being a very good example. You won't see Edelweiss in Wengen, but here you can see actually where this is early July and it's just coming out. It's not fully out. But Edelweiss is one that we will be finding in the Upper Engadine Valley. And we take the cable cars each day to go up very high. So we're often over 3,000 meters. And here we can look for some real high altitude specialties. And of course, the backdrop is stunning. This is the Bernina group of peaks that provide a really splendid backdrop to our daily excursions. So it's quite remarkable, really, what grows up here. This is a mignonette-leaved bittercress, a cardamomy. We'll see lots of glacier crowfoot and ranunculus. You'll see these pink splashes in the rocks, and these are alpine rock jasmines and Androsaceae alpina. And then if you take the cable car up and you see the blue splashes in the rocks, then that's another star of the trip. It's Eritrochium nanum, or King of the Alps. There's some different primulas up here as well. This one is a Primula latifolia, and this one is a Primula integrifolia. And there will also be hybrids of the two, just to keep you on your toes, so you never quite know what you're looking at. And here you can see all the purple in the turf. Now, again, we're quite high up, so we're still encountering quite a lot of snow melt. Even this was well into July by this point. So yeah, we're really high up, and you can see that some of the purples there are those primroses, but a lot of them are the snowbells as well. And they'll push their way up through, even through the snow melt, and then just sort of carpet the turf, turning it purple right the way, as you can see here up the hillside. Absolutely beautiful little things, and a real pleasure to look at. And once again, good picnic opportunities. This is probably one of my favourites. There's quite a good amount of walking involved in this tour. It's definitely one for people that like being out on foot all day long and doing a decent amount of walking. This, when I took this photo, this is the furthest we walk on any particular day, and it's probably about 10 miles in total. Again, you've got your pass if you don't want to do the whole thing, but from this picnic spot on, you're basically transecting a mountain. You're just gradually walking all the way back down to Pontresina, and you see all the different flora all the way along the way. So it's just a fantastic walk and amazing scenery as you go. So finally, I'm just going to mention Bettmeralp and Valais. So this is the newest tour that we have put together. Based in another car-free town, Bettmeralp. This time we fly into Geneva, and we take the train all the way around the lake and then up through the valley. We change onto a local train line just for the last sort of leg of the train journey. And then to get to Bettmeralp itself, you go by cable car. So you take your suitcase into the cable car, along with restaurants loading up their wines for the evening and all sorts. It's quite good fun. And again, it's a really lovely base. We're staying in a small family-run hotel. We're really well looked after. I think some of the best feedback I've had from any European tour has been from this particular hotel. And this is what's above us. So on a couple of days, we'll take the cable cars high up. And this is the Aletsch Glacier. It's the largest glacier in the Alps. It's 23 kilometres long. And it originates from those three peaks that we were looking at earlier, the Eiger, the Munch and the Jungfrau, which are just in this image, they're just round the corner, just out of sight. So we'll pick a nice sunny day to go up here, and then we can do some lovely walks. So again, you can see some glacier crowfoot there, just coming out with the glacier in the background. Plenty of lovely botany to be going at, as always, in the Alps. So St. Bruno's lily here. These are some lovely mountain house leeks. This is a white musky saxifrage. And then this is one of my favourites. This is a glacier mouse ear. I just love where the name comes from. We've set this particular tour up to be more of an all-rounder. So there's always going to be lots of botany in the Swiss Alps, but there's plenty of other things to see as well. There's normally some marmot families just up a chairlift behind our hotel. So one day we'll do a walk and we'll look for the marmots. We'll definitely be hearing them whistling, but we should have a really good chance of seeing them on this tour as well. And loads of butterflies too. We have a dedicated butterfly trip to Bengen, and on that one we might see perhaps over 100 species on a good sunny week. We wouldn't expect to see that many on this particular tour, and we're not just searching for butterflies, but perhaps over 50 is likely. So spotted fritillary we've got here. This is a scarce copper. This is a mountain clouded yellow. And this is an alpine heath. So lots of diversity and lots of things to be looking at. In terms of birding, you're not going to end up with an extensive bird list, but what is there is really nice to see. So here we've got an alpine chough, snow bunting, the aforementioned nutcrackers, and then on the bottom left, there's an alpine accenter. There's black red dots everywhere. There's like ring ouzels, dippers, lots to look for. And it's always worth keeping your eyes overhead because there's lammergeiers in the area, golden eagles are fairly commonly seen too. So as I said, not the most extensive bird list you'll ever have, but some really lovely stuff to be looking for. And then you can't go to Valais and not visit Zermatt and the Mighty Matterhorn. So on one of our days on this trip, we'll go back down the valley, we'll join the very last section of the Glacier Express route, and that will take us up to Zermatt, and then we'll continue on the Gornergratbahn, which you can see here, with the Matterhorn in the background, and we'll spend a day over this side of the valley, again, birding, butterflying, botanizing. There's some lovely things to look for. This is a Matterhorn pennycress, alpine asters, all sorts of lovely scenery, and hopefully the Matterhorn itself. Sadly here on the day that we went was a little bit covered in cloud, but hey, we can't quite organise that yet, but we will endeavour to try. So that is where I'm going to leave Switzerland. And I'm now going to move us a little way over to the east into Slovenia and talk about some of the highlights of Slovenia. I'm going to mention three different tours over the next 10 to 15 minutes or so. The first being our Alpine Flowers tour in the Julian Alps, and then we're going to move a little way further south. So just to give you a bit of context on where we are talking about at the moment, let's start with a map. So this is Slovenia in the middle, surrounded, not quite landlocked. There is a tiny, tiny section of coastline just there in the southwest corner, close to Trieste in Italy. So there's a tiny bit of coastline, but otherwise, we're surrounded by Italy, Austria, Hungary, and Croatia. And Slovenia is just, it's a really beautiful country. If you haven't been, you tend not to know much about it, but it's very green, very forested. There are mountains and lakes and rivers. It is absolutely delightful. It perhaps doesn't quite measure up with Switzerland in terms of that chocolate box village scenery and iconic alpine mountain, the mountains I've just been showing you. But it has got some fabulous botany, some real specialties for the Julian Alps that you wouldn't find elsewhere. It's got some lovely birding, a few bigger mammals, and to be honest, it's a lot cheaper. So that's always in its favour too. So we're going to start off with the Alpine Flowers Tour, which is in the very top northwest corner of Slovenia, close to the Italian border in the Triglav National Park. I'm then going to move us down to the south of Slovenia, closer to the Croatian border for the last few minutes of this section of the talk. So this is the Triglav National Park. The dotted black line on the top left there is the Italian border. So as I said, we're right up in that northwest corner. Where we stay is actually the bottom right corner of that map, where it says Bohin and Bohinsko Jezero, which is Lake Bohin. We're staying in a really nice hotel, the Hotel Jezero, the Lake Hotel, just literally on the lake there. And it's a one centre tour. We stay there for the whole week, so there's no having to move or pack your suitcases in between. We take minibuses on this tour. We're back on the road, so we have the freedom to go where we want, and we explore that whole national park, basically, going up the mountains, going to the plateaus, going over to the... through the gorges, along the rivers, all sorts during the course of the week. Now this photo is taken from the other end of the lake, and if you just squint a little bit at your screen, perhaps those of you who've got it on the telly will be able to see better. There's a tiny white blob at the far end. That's the church that's over the bridge from where our hotel is. Now this always makes me laugh because this tour was the first one that I put together shortly after joining Naturetrek back in 2012. And the reason I thought it'd be a great tour is that I'd been on a wild swimming trip the previous summer. So I joined a group of crazy outdoor swimmers. We had spent 4 days swimming in various lakes and rivers all over Slovenia, and we'd stayed in this hotel on Lake Bohin. Now, one of the days of that trip, we had hiked the 6 kilometres from our hotel to this point where I took the photo in the morning. We then swam the 4 kilometres back across the lake, and we're back at our hotel in time for lunch. Easy. So I thought, when I was putting this trip together as a young, naive operations assistant at Naturetrek, that you could definitely walk half around the lake in one day. And to be honest, I thought you could walk the whole way around because you've got the whole day to do it. So in the reality, on the very first day of the brand new tour, this is a botanical pace. I've learned a lot about that since. We wanted to identify everything. There was huge amounts of new things to see. I think by about 5 p.m. we'd made it to that sticking out bit of forest on the left-hand side of the photo, and I was having kittens about us missing the last boat back down the length of the lake. I think I managed to hustle everyone along in the end, and we did make it for the boats, but it was a great lesson for me in how fast botanists move, particularly on the first day of a tour in a brand new area with some fascinating things to look at. So we're out on foot again on this tour, spending most of our day on foot. We will start and end in the minibuses, but we're not tending to hop in and out of the minibuses too much. We tend to go to our base for the day, get out on foot and do a good walk. So perhaps up to 8 kilometres or so might be typical for a day. Here we are just above the same lake, exploring the meadows. Some days we'll go higher up, so we'll be out on these mountain paths. So again, it's for people that want to be out and walking a little bit during the course of their holiday. But as I said, we have minibuses with us. Nothing's compulsory. If you want to go potter along some of the way, head back when you're ready, then that's absolutely fine too. I mentioned that there's lots of lovely rivers and gorges and all sorts as well. So we'll do a bit of walking along those and botanizing the edges under the forest that line these gorges. And along here, we might see Lily of the Valley. This is a dark red helleborine. This is a diminutive little lesser tway blade. And this is a round-leaved wintergreen. So lots of lovely things to be looking at as we go along. And then from the gorges, you'll emerge out into the meadows. And again, there is some fabulous botany. So here in the meadows, and sometimes they'll have cut the lower meadows by the time we do this trip. Sometimes the higher ones are still there. It just sort of depends really on the season. But regardless, we'll find places where they're just filled to the brim with sweet William, with arnica, with bell flowers, with lilies, with orchids, all sorts. So lots of lovely orchids again on this trip. Here are a couple of the slightly more common ones. So this is a fragrant orchid on the left, and one of my favourites, this is the burnt tip orchid on the right. I mentioned the bell flowers already. Now this is a yellow bell flower, Campanula thysoides carniolica. So it's a specialty of the Julian Alps, and it's a subspecies that you'll only find in this particular area. Some fabulous lilies. This is the martagan lily, really out in full bloom, those fabulous pink flower heads. But the real special lily of this area of the Julian Alps is the carnic lily, Lilium carniolicum. Now the trip that I co-led, we were very excited when we found our first orange-headed lily, took lots of photos, really enjoyed it, and then from there it just got out of hand. We just kept seeing more and more and bigger and bigger, and then we found these sort of 9-headed orange monsters. So we'll certainly be looking for those and enjoying them during our week in Slovenia. On one of the days, we'll head over to a really special place called the Mangart Saddle. Now, this is one that's always formerly gave me slight palpitations in the office ahead of running this tour, because it's the road to the Mangart Saddle is closed for the entire winter by snow. And it's normally around the middle of June that it will reopen. We used to run our tours middle to end of June, and I've actually moved it a fraction later now into July, just to make sure I can sleep at night in the run up to this tour. But it's so worth the trip. You actually drive over the border into Italy, then head back on yourself, come back into Slovenia to visit this site. And again, there's some really lovely things to see. So This is a Primula hellerii, the Haller's primrose. This is an oxlip, Primula elatior. This is a particularly special poppy of the region, the Julian poppy, so one that we'll only see in this particular area, Alps. And this is a Zeus's bellflower, another really special plant for this particular tour. It grows readily in the limestone crevices of this area. And then finally, one that wasn't quite out in when we were in the Upper Engadine, but now is out in full bloom in the Julian Alps. This is the, of course, Edelweiss. So to finish, I'm going to move us south a little way in Slovenia. So we have two tours in a very close proximity, the first of which is Wild Slovenia. Now this area, so we're close to the border with Croatia now, and actually on our trips to Istria, which is a mishmash of Croatia and Slovenia, we'll come back over the border into Slovenia and visit the lakes in this area. But this is tour, Wild Slovenia, is based very close to Lake Cernica, which is a disappearing or an intermittent lake. It rises and falls by about 7 meters each year, and that's due to the karst topography, the limestone topography, which is really what much of the region's natural history revolves around and makes it so special. We stay in slightly quirky accommodation, I would say, on this tour. Quirky not being bad, just being different. We stay in a working farm, so it's not like you're rocking up at a hotel and all the rooms are the same and they've all got their identical en suites and you visit the restaurant. This is the farm, so you have your own individual room, some really good food cooked by the farm owners and our hosts. So it's a nice, slightly different approach. And I think what's so nice about this area is that it's a relatively easy flight. It's a very straightforward transfer. But when you get there, you just don't see anyone else, no other tourists. It just feels like you are the first group who's ever explored this area. And perhaps ever will again. You just really feel like you're out in the wilds, and it's lovely in that respect. So there's plenty of lovely botany too. So there's many, not all, the lower things that we'll have seen already in Slovenia, we might see on this tour as well. But there is some really excellent birding, butterflying, all around natural history. So this is a good tour for those of you that are real generalists, want to see a bit of everything, or for those of you that are perhaps a couple or two friends, where one who's more of a birder, one's more of a botanist, or one's more of a butterflyer, and you want to travel together, but both equally enjoy yourselves. So there's some real star birds on this tour. We'll explore the forests thoroughly, head up the mountains sometimes. We've got a very good chance of finding three-toed woodpecker. We will also look for middle spotted woodpecker. We've had very good chances of seeing them and good success rate. As we go through the villages and past the fields, we might see red-backed shrike. Certainly as we pass through some of the tiny villages, see these magnificent stork nests. And it's really nice for our leaders when they go back each year and see how many chicks they have and what's happened from one year to the next. And back in the forest, you might find some firecrest, things like that. So loads of lovely birding. And then one of the real highlights of this particular trip will be the chance to look for Ural owl. So again, it's a real star bird, and we've got a really good chance of finding it on this particular tour. Plenty for the butterflies to be going on with. So here we've got a poplar admiral, scarce fritillary. It's a pale clouded yellow down at the bottom. And then the other one at the bottom is an owl fly, like a type of lacewing. So lots of good things to be looking at. And then finally, I'm just going to mention the other tour we do in Slovenia, which is our Bears, Birds and Caves tour. Now this is actually one of Tom's tour, who'll be speaking just after the break. So any specific questions on this one, I would direct to Tom later. But it's literally based in the next village from where I was talking about for the Wild Slovenia tour. So very much in the same area, all the birds I've just mentioned, you've got really good chances of seeing on this particular tour as well. But you also will explore some of the caves. So I mentioned that this is a limestone area, so that's resulted in this magnificent cave system, and it's quite exciting to go and explore some of those along the way. And there are some big mammals in this area too. Most of them are very difficult, practically impossible to see. However, there are some wonderful bear hides around here, really natural in the forests. And we'll take you to there during this particular trip, and we'll go and look for the brown bears. You get some absolutely cracking views. So I've included this photo because it was taken in September 2020. Yes, in 2020. So we actually ran a handful of tours last year, in between lockdowns and tiers and all sorts. And one of them was this particular trip. So well done to the six or so intrepid travellers who went out and had a fabulous few days in Slovenia in September. They did some magnificent birding, butterflying, and they saw some lovely, lovely brown bears. So that is where I'm going to leave you. We've got the Q&A function here, so please just ask any questions as we go through the evening. My email address is on the screen there if you've got anything that you want to follow up with later. So kerrie@naturetrek.co.uk, very straightforward. So feel free to ask any questions that you might have. And I'll hand back now over to Sarah, and I think we're going to go for a short break. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Kerrie. That was fantastic. I really enjoyed listening to that. Really wonderful to reminisce of those Swiss trips. I have traveled as a Naturetrek client on both two of the tours that you mentioned, both to and to Engadine just a couple of years ago. I took my mum and she still talks about it. We had a fantastic time, really enjoyed it. We're just going to go to a short break now, and we're going to play some Sami music. It's a joik, which is a traditional and cultural song from the Sami people, who are native to northern Scandinavia, and that's to get you in the mood for listening to Kerrie's talk on Sweden, which she'll be doing later this evening. So we're back at 8:25. Do pop and get yourselves a drink if you would like a top up. If not, just sit, relax, and enjoy the music, and we'll be back in a short while. Thank you.
Hey! Thank you.
Okay, welcome back everybody. I hope you enjoyed your break. We're now going to go to Tom, who is going to take us over to the Camargue in France. Over to you, Tom.
Thank you, Sarah. Good evening, everybody. Just bear with me while I bring up my slideshow. Okay, welcome everyone. Hope you had a nice break and you've been enjoying the evening so far. My name's Tom Mabbett. I'm an operations manager for Naturetrek, and I look after a whole range of different tours across the UK and Europe and South America and Asia. And I've been lucky to get out and do a lot of tour leading as well. Lots of those tours in Western Europe, lots in France, Spain, Italy and Portugal. For the next 20 minutes or so, I'm going to take you to the wonderful Camargue, a place I've visited on a few occasions now, both on personal trips and tour leading, and just show you what a wonderful place it is. So I'll start with a bit of the geography. Where is the Camargue? It's down here, sort of in between Montpellier and Marseille, in the southwest of France. If we go zoom in a little bit, we can see how it's formed. It's the largest river delta in Western Europe. So we have the River Rhone here, which starts actually in the Swiss Alps, not too far from where Kerrie was talking about. And when it runs down, when it reaches the city of Arles, it sort of splits, and the main channel comes off down this way, and another arm comes across here. And this area, this delta in between those two legs of the Rhone, creates this fantastic habitat of wetlands, marshes, reed beds. It's a fantastic mix. About a third of this area is marshes and wetlands and these lagoons called etangs. It's a wonderful place to explore. So we either fly into Marseille or Montpellier, normally Montpellier, and it's very easy to reach by train as well, either into either of those cities or into Avignon. You can see at the top of the screen there. We base ourselves just outside Arles, about 15 minutes outside of Arles, so we can have easy access into the Camargue and some other areas as well. So we've got wetlands and marshes here, but a very short distance away, we have a very sort of stony desert area here, the Crau, and then the Appeal Mountains, just north of where we stay. So there's lots of different habitats to explore, and a great range of fantastic wildlife. I'll start with where we stay, really nice family-run hotel. They take very good care of us, cook us some delicious meals, and have looked after our groups for many years now. And as with lots of our tours across Europe, we choose our base to have some habitat on the doorstep, to get out and explore pre-breakfast walks, and to find lots of exciting species without really going further than the gardens a lot of the time. And that's the case here. A morning stroll will be straight into the action with some classic European species, pair of roller here. Always worth keeping your eyes to the skies as you're anywhere in this area. This is white stork flying overhead, and it can be very good for raptor passage, particularly on our spring tours. This is a pale faced booted eagle here, but we're likely to see black kites cruising over. Short-toed eagles, Montagu's harrier, honey buzzard migration can be very good in the spring. So there's lots to see just walking in the habitat around the hotel. This is a melodious warbler, and they're quite commonly seen in the spring from the hotel. And nightingales, which are often declining sadly a lot in the UK, they're seen very frequently, and their song is very beautiful song and heard often just around the grounds. Also at the hotel, if you're into your reptiles and amphibians, walk around with a torch at night, you might find a Moorish gecko up on the walls, or a stripeless tree frog often there behind the shutters on the windows of the hotel, actually. So lots to see just on our doorstep. And then we're heading now actually into the Camargue proper. So this is a classic scene really in the Camargue. This is a well-vegetated lagoon. There's lots of different lagoons, and they call them etangs. Some of these sort of saline lagoons, and they're just teeming with life. You can see lots of black-winged stilts out here. We like to have, herons and egrets and glossy ibis flying up all over the place. It really is a fantastic habitat. One of the highlights on a visit will be greater flamingos. This is another another sort of scenic shot of sort of some of the classic scene in the Camargue, and greater flamingos. You'll be seeing them, whichever time of year you visit. And I will say I'm going to be working through the seasons. Really, we have tours to the Camargue. I mean, the spring, short fortnight tours. We have week long tours, and then we also visit the area in the winter as well. So it has a lot to offer right throughout the season. We have our dragonfly tour, which I'll touch on as well, which is slightly late, well into the summer, our dragonflies and birds tour. So we have a number of different tours to the Camargue at different times of year, and each one is fantastic. So as I say, greater flamingos are a star, and this just shows you how close you can get to them. There's probably a few other places in the world really where you can get such fantastic views of wild greater flamingos, and they're actually one of the success story of 2020. Horrible year, I'm sure you'd agree, but for greater flamingos in the Camargue, it was a great one. They recorded their record numbers, 25,000 breeding pairs. So they think that with it much quieter than normal, far less disturbance, they took full advantage of that. So a success story for the flamingos of the Camargue last year. They nest here, one of the very few colonies in Western Europe, and often on islands. And then, they're very prone to disturbance. So they did very well last year. So it's a bit of good news for you. Again, fantastic photographic opportunities here of these wonderful birds. And the bird life's prolific. Squacco heron here, stunning heron. You'll be seeing purple heron, little bitterns. Lots of different species, night herons, just the whole assemblage really of European herons, cattle egret, great egret, little egret. They're all there, and they all do very, very well in this vast mix of habitats and wetlands. More classic European species, beater here, and they're very commonly seen. And you can really see all your sort of brightly coloured classic European birds on a spring visit, spring and summer visit to the Camargue. And this is just another scene, really. Sort of, there's areas of vast reed beds and lovely channels, and it's sort of a scene like this that I remember from a video I watched. I was about 10 or 11 years old and absolutely mad on birds, even more so than I am now, I suppose. And just flicking through, seeing all these magical birds, and one of the places to go, one of the mega places, was the Camargue, and it was a Tony Soper video, and he was punting along a channel like this, with lots of birds all over the place. Bearded tits pinging in the reed beds and flying up around the place, squawker herons piling out of the reeds and purple herons flying over, and just thought, wow, I have to get to this wetland. It was one of the first places I visited once I was old enough to rent a car abroad. We headed over there and explored it. It was fantastic. Penduline tit, another species which were very likely to come across, nests in these, where they get the name from, these hanging nests made pretty much purely of plant material. And often some spiders' webs to knot them together. They hang often in these in willows, they're a star of the area that we hope to find. And terns, of course, there's lots of water bodies. The terns will feature. This is a whiskered tern here. We'll also see gullbill tern, Caspian tern, little tern. Lots of different species to find. Great spotted cuckoo in the spring and summer. Not as easy as in some areas of Spain, but they do breed here. They parasitise magpies in a lot of cases, and other corvids, so another star species to find. And Kerrie touched on the picnics, and it's a feature. I've been lucky enough to lead lots of these tours where, as a leader, we're driving the minibus, we're finding the picnic spot, we're cooking for picnics, and finding the birds. It's fantastic fun, and I've loved every moment doing these tours. And we'll find a lovely spot like this. This I couldn't find a photo of a picnic in the Camargue, unfortunately. This is one from Spain, and we'll find a lovely spot and have a picnic out in the field, surrounded by the wildlife, and it's a lovely way to break up the day. You might see black storks migrating through here in the spring. Another star bird we hope to encounter, and yet more your classic European species, beautiful hoopoe here. They're quite numerous and seen often. Golden oriole, just the list goes on really of sort of wonderful bird species you can see here. Wader watching is very good again in the spring. Lots of passage waders. This is wood sandpiper. So I'll pass through here in good numbers, and we'll be travelling around and stopping at lots of different sites. And you often have flocks of dunlin with little stint in amongst them, temminck stint, ruff, spotted redshank, avocet, lots of different wading birds, and collared prattingole here. There's an awful lot to see. Kentish plover, another species. So lots and lots of birds. It's not all about the birds though. We will be enjoying everything, of course, as we do on all our tours. We're enjoying everything we come across. The famous Camargue white horses, and we'll hope to find them and watch them walking through this habitat. And mammal-wise, mammals are thin on the ground really in the Camargue, but this is one you're likely to see. It's a coipu, it's rather beaver-like, but with sort of a long, slender tail rather than that big paddle tail of a beaver. And they're numerous in the wetlands around the Camargue. So that's a very quick coverage of the Camargue in spring, sort of the delta area and the wetland. Just next door is a stony sort of desert area really of La Crau, which we'll stop at and explore, and a whole range of different species, of course. Stone curlew, short-toed lark here. There's also calandra lark and Richard's pipit occasionally in winter, and tawny pipit in the spring and summer. Lots of different species. This is Little Buster. There's still a few pairs here. They've sadly declined quite considerably across their range in Europe. And it's one of the last places in France where you have a chance of seeing the species. This is a beautiful male flying across the stony desert here. So there's lots of habitats to explore. And it's a fantastic experience. This is the Appeal Mountains. So these, again, are only 20 minutes or so drive from our base. So we've got easy access to all these habitats, and just a wonderful array of species to find. In the summer, spring and summer up here, Alpine swift is a species we'll be looking out for, which is larger than our European swift with this big white belly. Blue rock thrush, again, quite a common species in these mountainous areas and in towns as well, on buildings. And black red starts are a common species across lots of Europe and on a lot of our European tours, but a stunning bird nonetheless, male here with that lovely silvery wing, jet black throat. Moving into the summer, we have, as I mentioned, our dragonflies and birds tour. So this is a group I was with, and taking photos of dragonflies and damselflies in these lovely vegetated channels, make it one of the best places in Europe. Four dragonflies we can expect to see, around 30 different species on a tour, and of course all the fantastic summer birds alongside them. So it's an excellent, really excellent tour. It's this large pincer tail. Spotted darter is another star species down here. It's a distinctive spotting along the abdomen here. And banded darter is another sort of star species that we find down here on the tour, and our guys know exactly where to find them, all these different species, and have great knowledge of the area. So it's a fascinating tour if you're into your dragonflies. I really, really recommend it. And this is Mediterranean bluet, more sought after species, and this is one of the best places, actually right next to that stony desert, a lovely channel there, one of the best channels in all of Europe for dragonflies, damselflies and demoiselles. This is the copper damoiselle. We don't have that species here in Britain, but it's quite widespread down in the Camargue. Butterflies, of course, as we're going along, if you're into your butterflies, that summer tour is going to be suited to. This is red underwing skipper, blue spot fritillary here, and southern gatekeeper. So an awful lot to see on that summer tour, that dragonflies and birds. It's a super tour to see a real array of different species, your birds, your butterflies, your dragonflies. It's superb. The fun doesn't stop when you get to the winter in the Camargue. So we also run a winter tour for, of course, the wintering species. We have our wall creepers tour, and we also run a tour either across Christmas or New Year. This is a shot of Le Beau, which is one of the towns in the Appeal Mountains, and it's the scene for one of the highlights of a winter visit to the Camargue area, and that's to look for the enigmatic wall creeper. So this is the group scanning the walls around the town, and looking for that magic moment when you pick up that flash of red in the wing of a wall creeper. And here's a shot of the bird itself. So, special bird, and it's one of the best places to see one, really, in Western Europe in winter. In the winter, they're dropping lower down, so they don't breed here. In the summer months, they're higher up in the Pyrenees and other higher mountainous areas breeding, and then they drop down lower in the winter, and are far more accessible in the winter time. And that's when we find them. Here's a close up, absolutely stunning bird. At Le Beau, there's a castle at the very top. So if we walk up here and scour this area, we're likely to come across Alpina Centre. There's lots of interest, lots of star birds in the winter. It's a very good place to spot Bonella's eagle from up here as well. You're going to be seeing lots of other species, crag martin flying around. Just a special array of birds across the winter months too. This is the Pont de Gare, a Roman aqueduct that we'll visit on our winter tours. Again, it's a regular site for wintering war creeper, and this stunning aqueduct to enjoy at the same time. Often rock sparrows around here and blue rock thrushes flying around. Lots and lots to look at and enjoy. Just another shot of the aqueduct with a group below it, doing some winter birding. We'll head up Mount Ventoux. This is around 2,000 meters high. Site of a famous leg of the Tour de France, and again another habitat to explore. This sort of upland, mountainous, pine, coniferous forests. There's another sort of array of species that we hope to find here. It's very good in the winter. Crested tit is quite commonly seen in the foothills of the mountain. Black woodpecker, and black woodpeckers will breed here frequently seen, and we stop off a few stops on the way up to try and listen for them. The call is amazing. They're incredibly noisy and often alert you to their presence. Citral finch, another star bird, cracking little finch that's found on Mount Ventoux here. Back around the Camargue in winter, superb, of course. This is large numbers of wintering black-necked grebe visit. This is a beautiful male hen harrier, caught in the grasslands and reed beds. Touring around the Camargue Delta and the rough ground around the marshes and lagoons, the Etangs, are very good for your raptors. Merlins will be seen as well. Black-winged kites here. There's a few pairs, but it's much more like to see in winter. And this is a photo taken. War Creepers tour we ran in January 2020, just before the lockdown. Fantastic views of black-winged kite. And flocks of glossy ibis are quite commonly seen in the winter months. Large numbers and good flocks are seen. And common crane, just another spectacle. The list goes on, really, of the star species we can find. This is a bird that used to be fairly scarce in the Camargue, even in the early 2000s. And their numbers have increased. There's around 15,000 now winter in the Camargue. It's a fantastic experience, the trumpeting calls of crane drifting overhead as you're exploring the Camargue. It's a wonderful experience. And in the arable fields, just on the outskirts of the delta, you can often have flocks coming down and feeding in great numbers now. So it's another wonderful experience to be had in the Camargue. So that's a whistle stop. I'm running out of time rapidly. It's a destination for the year round. And it's one of those just mega destinations of Western Europe, really. You know, if anyone asks me, where do you recommend going to see such a wide range of European birds and habitats, you know, Camargue is right up there at the top of the list. I'll leave you with this photo of a flock of spoonbill one evening flying over Camargue, and I hope you enjoyed the tour. Any questions, I'll be delighted to help, and I hope you can visit one day if you haven't already. Thanks very much. I'm going to pass you now back over to Kerrie, and she's going to take you to Sweden.
Hello everyone, I am back. I will just fire up my next presentation, so bear with me for one moment and we'll get going again. Sorry, technical hitch. Get myself in the right place. Okay, we're up and running. So to finish off our evening on Western Europe, I am going to take you over to Sweden, talk through the various tours that we operate here at various times of year. So let's kick off with a map, get our context, and I'll show you where I'm going to be taking you for the last 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes I think we have now, before we move on to the questions at the end of the evening. So our tours all fly into Stockholm Airport. They don't all actually, but they all go at least through there. Majority fly into Stockholm Airport. And then in the springtime and in the winter for our shorter long weekend breaks, we're based in central Sweden in a place called Svartdalen, which is probably about an hour and a half's drive from Stockholm, maybe a fraction over that. And that is the lower and the most southerly of those three black circles on the map. That's the Svartdalen area. So our Sweden in spring tour in May, our Sweden winter tour in February are based entirely in this area. We also start and finish our slightly longer upland birds tour, which operates at the end of May, early June, in the same Svartdalen area. So we'll start there and finish there, but we'll also travel further north up to that second, the middle black circle, up as far as the uplands, as the name suggests, with stops on the way there and back. And then I was going to finish the evening by speaking a little bit about our Swedish Lapland tour. So that's the one that doesn't fly just into Stockholm. You fly through Stockholm all the way to Luleå, on the coast there in the far north, and then you drive further north still over the Arctic Circle border line into Jokkmokk. And mostly we stay in this town Jokkmokk, and one night we'll go a little bit further north yet. We'll kick off though with springtime in Sweden. And I mean, there's a couple of really solid reasons to be heading to Sweden in the springtime. The first of which is the woodpeckers. There are seven possible species of woodpecker that we can look for. All are possible on a long weekend on our Sweden spring tour. I think we've seen all seven probably in one go. I can't totally vouch for that without looking back, but certainly we'll see a couple of the rarities and along with the more common species. So here we've got black woodpecker, lesser spot and three-toed. We also have a good chance of finding greater spot, of course, green woodpecker, grey-headed and wryneck. So that's the seven altogether. Very close to where we're staying, there was a huge forest fire a few years ago now, maybe 3 or so years ago. It was very worrying at the time, looked to me definitely a sign of climate change in action. One of the positives that's come out of it is a fantastic section of burnt out forest, which is pristine woodpecker habitat, lots of dead trees. So we'll spend one of the days there on our spring tour with their local woodpecker man, going around and seeing what we can see. The second excellent reason to go to Sweden in the springtime is the owls. You've got, if you join us for a week at the end of May, you might see perhaps five or more species of owl. On the shorter weekend in the south, you've got a really good chance of Ural owl that we've got here. Pygmy owl, tawny eagle, short-eared, great grey owl, tame-worms owl is possible too. So it is just fantastic. So Ural owl, we'll certainly be looking for on all of those springtime trips. We'll head out around dusk on one or two evenings and look for pygmy owls. We've got a really great network of birders and guides in this area, so they tend to know pretty much where they are. So you'll head out, look for this tiny little diminutive owl peeping at the tops of the trees and hope to watch one of those at dusk. And then the absolute prize, the star of the show on any of these ships is the grey owl. We actually used to fly into a very little airport in Västerås, very close to where we're staying. There were pluses and minuses of this. It was a Ryanair flight, which no one ever likes. But the big positive was it's very close to where we're staying, so sort of half an hour's drive away. The route's now been cancelled and the airport's closing, so it's not an option anymore. But the year that I co-led our Upland Birds tour, we did fly into there on an evening flight, and then we went straight from the airport to the site for the Great Grey Owl because our guide knew that there had been one there earlier in the evening. So it was probably about 40 minutes from plane wheels touchdown to being in this very spot, looking at this very owl. And oh my goodness, suitcases were just scattered in the road as everyone got their binoculars out, their cameras ready. And we were there watching a magnificent Great Grey Owl only hours after leaving the UK. Quite a start to the week. We'll often visit a quarry as well, a classic location for birding. There's often an eagle owl nest in this particular quarry, so we'll go and have a look and see if we can see those chicks, which are nicely camouflaged. Have a look for them. And during our spring weekend in May, we will try and join some local ringers. Now, it does depend a little bit on timings, obviously, who's around, who's been born, when they've been born and whatnot, but if possible, we'll join some local ringers and we might get some really close views of, here we've got some tame-worms owls chicks and some Ural owl chicks. Sightings of tame-worms owls do tend to depend on it being a good vole year. So I often get asked if it's a good vole year this year. The vole populations are very cyclical. They are very boom and bust. So, and they tend to be on a sort of a 3-year cycle. So if it's a good vole year, you've got good chances of tame-worms owls. If it's a bad vole year, it's not game over. It just means they tend to have smaller clutches or perhaps they'll lay their eggs a little bit late in the season. So it's just a little bit more unreliable. But if possible, then we might have a good chance of seeing them and their chicks too. And just generally, there's some really lovely birding to be done as we're going around the Svartedalen, the Black River Valley area. So here we've got autumn bunting, common rose finch there, cuckoo. There's lots of stories about cuckoos in Sweden. My favourite one being that if you hear a cuckoo before breakfast, you'll go mad. And the cure for this is vodka. We will be looking for and listening for thrush nightingale in the hedges as well, quails, cranes, spotted crakes booming around. What have we got here? So yep, cranes I mentioned, lots of warblers, it's a great reed warbler, redback shrike, plenty of raptors overhead too. So we were looking for osprey, there's marsh harriers around, white-tailed eagle, henny buzzard is possible, goshawk's possible. We'll just be kept busy all day long really. That's as far as we go on our those shorter weekend tours. But as I said, if you come with us on our Upland Birds tour, which is a week-long tour at the end of May or early June, we'll start heading further north. So we go to here, the Green Hotel, long favoured by Swedish royalty. And as we go further north, we'll start seeing a few more northerly species. So bramblings start to get more common. Chances of some much rarer birds like Siberian tit here. Loads of redwings and field fares all in their breeding plumage. Chance of ringers all now. And then from this area, we also have a good chance of hawk owl, which you wouldn't normally see on the shorter, further southerly, more southerly weekend trips. Not in the springtime anyway, you might in the winter. But where we're heading now a bit further north, then we do start having a chance of hawk owl. So we'll make a special effort on the way north and on our way back down south again to find a hawk owl in this particular area. We'll also stop here at Thulu Fialet National Park. It's a lovely place to go for a walk up to this waterfall. You'll start seeing loads of bramblings from this point. They're starting to get really common, but it's also a known nest site for geofalcons. So we'll go and have a look and see if they're there this year. It's kind of a case of looking for some white splatter on the cliffs and going from there. And then the scenery starts to change. So you can see the snow on the uplands now. There's lots of lakes that we're driving past, and on those you can look for common and velvet scoters, wood sandpipers, black-footed divers, all sorts of things. And then gradually the forests will disappear and we'll get out onto the tundra. We'll start seeing herds of these semi-domesticated reindeer. They've lost their antlers in the summer, so they have these very funny little velvety furry horns. And they'll be clip-clopping around the roads and getting in the way of the vehicles and all sorts as we go about our daily adventures. So out here on the tundra, we'll do some longer walks. We'll stop by some of these pockets of water and see what we can see. So the beautiful red-necked phalarope will again be in its breeding plumage. This one's an adult female. Red-necked phalaropes they reverse the typical male and female roles, so it's the brighter females that lead the courtship and it's the duller males that look after the eggs and the young ones hatch. I'm a big fan of red-necked phalaropes actually. And this is a long-tailed skua with its beautiful delicate tail streamers. We should see them flying overhead when we're up on the tundra. Here we've got willow ptarmigan, golden plover. It's not guaranteed, but we've got a really good chance of finding dotterel, beautiful black-throated diver here, good chance of ruff. And I think what's really nice about this trip is that you're seeing all these birds that we often have in Britain in their dull winter plumage, and they're here in their breeding plumage. And I know the year that I co-led this tour, one of the ladies commented that she had never really thought about why ruff might be called a ruff. But suddenly, when you're here watching them displaying, it's completely obvious why they're called a ruff. It's really nice to see. Lapland bunting are common up on the tundra, so we should definitely see little flocks of them flying around. And another star of this particular part of the trip is the blue throat, with this lovely little orange dot. They're reasonably common around here too, and the best tactic really is just to drive the minibus along the road, stop every few hundred metres, listen out, and it won't take too many stops until you've heard a blue throat and located it. Siberian jay are another highlight. The first time you go on a birding trip to Sweden, it's a bit unusual because your tour leader will say, oh, we're going to go and see if we can see a Siberian jay. Great. Then they'll go to the supermarket and buy some sausage. What's all this about? But they have known sites and they do like their Swedish sausage. So if you go and buy yourself a Swedish sausage and pop a few little chunks on one of these trees, sure enough, a Siberian jay will come down and help itself, and you can get a nice photo and a really good view. Another big highlight of this particular part of the trip is that one night after dinner, pretty late on, we'll head out and we will walk across this tundra sort of area again, and we will head towards a great snipe lek. It's quite tough going as a tour leader this trip because it doesn't get dark. This is probably about 11 p.m. So here we are watching the great snipe lek. These birds are busy displaying, and even though it is the middle of the night, you can still get great photos and great views because it just doesn't go dark. As I said, it's quite tiring as a tour leader because you're driving and working all day long, but the reward is marvellous. You have incredible birding throughout the trip. And obviously, as a group participant, there's no pressure to do everything and to go out every night or whatnot. The offer's there, and we'll always head out after dinner to look for owls, to do the great snipe lek, whatever it is. But you don't have to if you're tired. You are allowed to go to bed. After this point, we will then head back down south on this particular trip. We'll stop again along the way, try for different owls, different woodpeckers, pick up anything we've missed, and finish back in the Svartedalen, central Sweden area before we fly home. So in that same sort of area in central Sweden, we also run a Sweden's Mammals tour. We're slightly further north here, but not much at all. I'm still in that general area. I'm in a place called Bergslagen. And here we run a lovely 4-night, 5-day trip looking for the sorts of mammals that have been long extinct in the British Isles. So we're looking for beaver, for European Eurasian elk. They normally call them moose in Sweden. We'll go out listening for wolves, and there's possibility of lynx. Tom went on this trip and saw a lynx. Mountain hares are the smaller species as well. We did also used to include a night in a bear hide. Now, sadly, they've been closed during the last year, and they were very close to retirement, just a couple anyway, so they've decided not to reopen post-COVID, which is really sad. We haven't got a very good replacement. Everywhere else that we know of, or really that exists at all, is a bit too small, a bit too far away. So as things stand, you're not likely to see a brown bear on this particular trip. I don't think it matters, because I have visited this area and done this tour, and it's just so lovely regardless. That a bear used to be the icing on the cake, but it wasn't the be all and end all. There's so much to go at. We're staying in this guest house, the Udden guest house. It's set on a lake. During the day, we take it a bit easier, really. Sometimes we'll take the canoes out and go for a paddle. We go for nice forest walks, do a bit of birding, see if there's any daytime mammals out. But most of the big stuff we're looking for comes out at dusk or shortly after. So one evening we'll go on a moose safari. We'll take the minibuses and then we'll go for some walks. And the moose tend to stay in the depths of the forest, hiding away in the dark during the day. But when you get to dusk, they'll come out and they'll start grazing the meadows along the roadsides. And you can see maybe 15, 20 or so moose as you're venturing around in the evening. There we go. We'll also go out one evening looking for beavers. So we'll go out on an electric boat and we'll just drift silently, quietly down the river, look for these huge beaver lodges, these huge impressive structures. The one on the top right there, you can actually see Udren Guest House in the background. And then that's the beaver lodge in the foreground. And then we'll go out looking for beavers. And probably the highlight of the trip is an evening spent out in wolf territory. So during the day, we will go and walk through the forests. Our guides know these areas so well. They spend the whole time out looking for wolves and tracking different mammals. And so we'll go and look at the wolf tracks, learn some techniques for finding out how we know where they've been and what they've been up to. And then we'll head back out after dark one night, build a fire, sit under the stars, and our guide will try and initiate a conversation with the local wolf packs. They'll howl, and fingers crossed we'll hear the local wolves howl back. And then just to finish, I'm going to spend a couple of minutes telling you about our tour to Swedish Lapland. Last January, I was feeling a little bit put out that my husband was organising a ski trip with his friends, and I hadn't got any plans booked. So quite short notice, I popped myself onto our trip to Swedish Lapland last January. And oh my goodness, am I glad I did that, because it's kept me going the entire year, the memories of it. And I've seen there's one of my fellow group members is on here this evening. So good to see you. This is just a really stunning area and quite a different nature trek tour. There isn't prolific amounts of wildlife up there. So you're not going to come back with a mighty mammal or bird list by any stretch of the imagination. But what an experience it is. So as I said, we fly into Luleå, we drive north to Jokkmokk. We're based there for 3 nights. And during those three days we have, we'll go out on a husky safari. So we'll help get the dogs ready, and then we'll just go sailing off along these sort of lake and forest paths, stop for fika, which is cinnamon buns and coffee in a larvu, a teepee, and then have a look at bird feeders, carry on back. One of the days we'll go out looking for moose and doing birding. The day that we went, we just drove east from west from Jokkmokk, and we just got better and better moose sightings as we went along. The first one was sort of a bit hidden, but very exciting. And then by the end, there was a mother with twin calves just basically on the road next to us. Just really wonderful to see. And then at the end of our adventure on the road, we built a fire overlooking the lake. We toasted some toasties and had some hot soup over the fire, enjoyed the scenery and made our way back. There's plenty of these semi-domesticated reindeer again venturing around, and one of the evenings we'll have dinner with a lovely reindeer herder called Anna. She's one of the local Samis, and we'll hear all about her culture. That was quite a revelation for me. I didn't really know anything about Sami culture and the history of that particular population in this part of Scandinavia. But she's just a fascinating person, and you'll just learn loads as you go around, and quite an enlightening experience, really. Again, not a prolific bird list, but what is there is very nice. So another good chance of Siberian jay. Here's a crested tit on Artoria demarcus, aka looks like a sacrificial victim here. There's a really good bird feeder just outside Jokkmokk. So there'll also be bullfinches, hopefully, possibly Siberian tit, willow tit. We saw lots of black grouse. I think we saw about 30 fly overhead at one point. So some really nice stuff to be going at. And then each evening we'll go out, find ourselves a nice looking lake, position ourselves looking north, build a fire, take along some hot lingonberry juice to keep us warm, and we'll look for the northern lights. Now, full disclaimer, we didn't really see them when I went. I don't think I'm very good at finding northern lights. I've tried a few times on various trips, never had any success. So I would suggest if you want to see them, just don't book on a trip with me. But it also just didn't matter. It was such a wonderful trip regardless. It just didn't matter that we didn't see them. Although actually we sort of saw them one night. We saw a bit of a fuzzy arc in the sky. We took a photo of it and it came out green. So they were there, but it was just a bit cloudy, sadly, when we went. And I think we were quite unlucky because it is a dry part of the country, quite inland. So it should be clear a lot, but it just didn't work out for us. But it was just so nice going out in the night anyway, looking at the stars, experiencing the stillness surrounded by snow. And then really the highlight for many will be the night that we go glamping at Sapmi Nature Camp. So that's probably another hour and a half or so further north of Jokkmokk still, getting snowier, even more beautiful. And this is the camp that we stay at. So each person or couple have one of these lavus. There's a little log cabin just to the right there that we have our dinner in. Don't worry about the toilet situation. There's lots of options. Some of them are heated, they're all fine. And then we can borrow cross-country skis or snowshoes and head out to explore. So you can go across this lake. When we went, we took our head torches and it was pretty dark by the time we got across the lake, and we came back by torchlight. And sometimes, you just turn them off and listen to the stillness. And it's like, I keep saying it's magical, but it really was. It was wonderful. The night of the lavus, don't worry about being cold. You have a wood-fired stove that our host there will ramp up during the day and keep going for you. Then at bedtime we'll also fire a paraffin heater. I was on the side of the bed closest to the stoves and I was sweating. It was hot, so it's just a really lovely experience. And I would highly recommend, if you want to experience some real winter rather than the rain that we tend to have here in the UK, along with some lovely wildlife, then this is definitely the experience for you. So that's where I'm going to leave things. So again, contact details there. We're here now to answer any questions. So please stick around and grill us to your heart's content. So I'll pass back to Sarah. And thank you very much again for listening.
Great. Thank you so much, Kerrie and Tom. Both fantastic presentations. Loads of lovely comments coming in there. Not all of you may be able to see them, but a lot of them are coming directly to us. Just wonderful presentations, says Jenny. Want to go on all of the trips. Another brilliant evening, enticing presentations from Christine. There's lots of lovely comments. So thank you all very much. We'll go to some questions now. Tom, there's been a couple of questions about the weather in the Camargue. Just talk us through it. What's it like in the winter? What are the temperatures like? Is it raining? And what's it like in the summer? Do you need to be worried about mosquitoes? What's the deal?
Okay, it's, you can expect it to be milder, nicer version of in the UK normally, but there is there is what they call the mistral wind. So if you're there in the winter, and some of our winter tours have, you know, nice, mild, pleasant conditions, you know, just more pleasant than it is here, obviously being further south. But if that mistral wind is blowing, it can get very cold in the winter. So well worth if you're going on a winter trip there, taking some warm clothes, and even the spring trips, if that wind's blowing, you can have that wind chill factor. So definitely worth taking some layers with you. But once you get into the later spring summer tours, it can really ramp up the heat. It can be very hot there. And often we have to nip back to the hotel and have a little relax by the pool. So it can get hot. So hope that summed it up. Mosquito wise, we get very few comments on the mosquitoes, really. You would think as a huge wetland, you'd be crawling with mozzies. That's not the case. Occasionally we have a few comments, when they're sat outside of the hotel, the odd mosquito around. But I obviously look at all the feedback from the tours over quite a number of years now, and they rarely get a mention. But they're still worth taking your repellent. If you're sat having a drink outside the hotel in the evening, whack a bit of repellent on and you'll be fine.
Great, thank you. And a question on weather for the Lapland trip, Kerrie. How cold does it get, and do you advise cold weather gear?
Yes, very good question. It can get super cold. So 2 years ago, it was hitting minus 30. Now that is seriously cold. When we were there last January, everyone local was complaining about how warm it was. And it was probably minus 15 or so at the coldest. I strongly recommend cold weather gear, and you can hire that locally. So our local guides have basically bought a whole load of kit, which they keep up there, and you can rent that out from them. It's all the Fjällräven, really, really good quality stuff, and I would just do that. You get the super padded coat, super hat with the furry ears, proper boots, proper mittens, and that keeps you nice and toasty. So you need to be kitted out.
Great, thank you. Christine says, is there any way I could do the Camargue trip, the Polish trip, the Romanian trip, the Albanian trip, the Swedish trip, all in the same year?
Just get booking.
I'm sure we could try and work that out for you. Also the polar bear trip, she's just followed that with as well. So if you'd like to go to Spitsbergen as well.
There might be one or two clashes there, but we can see what we can do.
We'll see what we can sort out, Christine, yeah. A question now on the Swiss Alps. Is there any risk of altitude sickness in the Swiss Alps? That's from Maurice Brill.
No, I would say no is the quick answer to that. I mean, you are going high, and in the Upper Engadine, you're going to over 3,000 metres. But, in the 8 years or so I've been running those tours, I've never heard of anyone actually getting altitude sickness. You might feel a bit breathless walking uphill, which we don't do much of anyway. And if we do, we go at a really slow pace. But no, it's not the sort of place where you need to think about sickness tablets or anything like that. And no, I've not heard of anyone on our trips having any issues.
Okay. A question from Peter Grout here. Do we make much use of hides, or do you stumble on species? Hopefully not literally. This was in reference to the Camargue trip. I saw this appearing during your talk, Tom.
Yeah. So there are hides at some of the reserves. We're mainly out walking around the reserves, viewing on foot, and there's some observation towers as well that we'll use. So it's a bit of a mix, but most of the viewing will be, on foot, walking around, scanning the marshes and wetlands on foot. Really, we don't spend lots of time sat in hides.
I think that's probably true for most of our trips around Europe as well. It's rare that we'll be going from hide to hide and sitting in the same place all day. We tend to be out on foot exploring, seeing what we see along the way. There's just the odd place where there might be a hide or a good viewing platform, that sort of thing.
Yeah, okay. Just having a look for another question. Jenny Craddock says, in the Slovenia trip, is there any chance of lake or river swimming?
Yes. Now, as you know from my talk, I'm a keen wild swimmer. So I took my cozy with me and popped in the lake during one of our picnic lunches, which I think most of the group thought was quite funny, but perfectly possible to do. Probably the easier option is to go for an ice swim in the lake when you get back into the hotel in the evening. So I mean, I was doing that as well. But yeah, if you're a keen swimmer, just take your cozy with you, go in at lunchtime.
We've had a couple of questions just asking if recordings will be available after this for not only this presentation, but future ones. Yes, we do make them available. Do just email us at info@naturetrek.co.uk and we can send you a link to the recordings. That's no problem. Kerrie, another question for you. It's a lady's interested in taking her mum on a botany tour. She can walk probably 3 miles at a botany pace, a botanist's pace. Is there a particular trip that you'd recommend that's mostly plant focused without 10 miles that you're covering during the day?
Yeah. So in the areas that I've been talking about, probably the best bets would be the Go Slow in the Swiss Alps tour that I mentioned. That's the one that's based in Murin, which is the same area as in Wengen. I think probably a fraction over 3 miles, I would say, during the course of the day, but not much over. And it's definitely been designed for people that really want to visit that area but don't want to be walking long distances. And we purposely built an inherent sense of flexibility. So you've got your pass. Each walk is designed so you can do a shorter distance or a longer distance, or get the cable car back down if you don't want to do any distance. So there are a lot of options within the tour. And if we have two tour leaders, then they will have a sort of slightly more hardcore group and a less hardcore group. So that's a good one to look at. Or in a sort of similar area, a trip that would have been new for last year, but obviously didn't actually happen because of COVID, is Go Slow in the Austrian Alps, where we stay in a really lovely hotel. And again, we've got a transport pass for the week. And we're exploring, it's the Austrian Alps this time rather than Swiss Alps, but a similar sort of vibe, great botany, some nice birding, great butterflies, and an inherent sense that built-in flexibility so that you can opt in and out a bit and we're not walking great distances at all. And that one, they do happy hour at the hotel when you get back, half price beer and cake. So that's always good.
That's fantastic. If you do have any more questions, do just send them in. We'll stay here for the 5 or 10 minutes or so. We've got quite a few people sending us messages over the chat with lovely comments. Thank you all so much. Claire Edie says, another brilliant evening. New ideas as well, bringing back fond memories. Liz Layden says, thanks for the presentations. Can't wait to get traveling again. Other comments, really enjoyed the evening. We'll be back on Tuesday. So lots of lovely comments coming in. And can't wait to get out into the world again from Yvonne. Yeah, we can't wait to get sending you out again, Yvonne. True that, I think. Do we have any more questions for our panelists this evening? Or Kerrie and Tom, do you have anything that you'd like to add?
I think I've covered what I want, really.
I've rabbited on half the evening, so yeah. You're probably done with me now. So would you have any of my favourite places?
Oh, fantastic. Well, we have another one that's just popped in. This is a quite difficult one to answer. This is from Judy. What availability is there on all Naturetrek trips? As I understand, many people have postponed trips from 2020.
That's a good question, isn't it? Mm. Do you want to say that?
Yeah, fine. Yeah.
I mean, it's impossible to give you a definitive answer because there's hundreds of trips and they'll all have different availability. I think thinking through like my tours, I think there's spaces on most things. There's the odd one that I can think of where literally the whole group has transferred from last year to this year. But in those cases, we added extra departures, hoping that things will be picking back up again. I think it's quite rare that we've got just a fully booked group and there's nothing to be done. So the best thing to do is probably to pop onto our tour calendar on the website. There's a link from the homepage, and you can just scroll through all the tours by month, and then it will show you how many places there are, and it will say if they're full. You can always give us a call in the office, and we'll let you know. But we do have availability, and we're just keeping our fingers crossed, really, that we can get going again in the spring and get to have some of these marvellous places that we're all missing.
Great, thank you, Kerrie. We've had another question come in while you've been answering that one from Moira Hamilton. She says, are your clients mainly very knowledgeable birders or botanists, etc., as that puts me off a bit, as an enthusiastic, interested amateur? Well, I'm happy to answer this question. I'd say you will have a place on a nature trek tour as long as you're interested. As long as the interest is there in the wildlife, don't be worried at all by that. Some of our clients that we have in our groups are very keen, knowledgeable naturalists. Others, it might be their first experience of it, of really being on a dedicated wildlife holiday. It's their first time bird watching or looking for butterflies or looking for plants. And I can answer that question actually both as a tour leader, where I've had first time clients on a holiday, they've never been on a dedicated wildlife holiday before, who've all come back and said, you know, I wasn't made to feel like I didn't know enough or anything like that. I just had a fantastic time. And also from a client's point of view, because I've taken my mum on the two Swiss tours that Kerrie mentioned, and my mum isn't any more than a keen gardener, these are dedicated botany holidays, and botany certainly isn't my strong point. Whales and dolphins are my forte, but I had the interest there, but I certainly didn't have the knowledge, but we absolutely loved the trips. David, the tour leader, is just a walking encyclopedia. He's so incredibly patient, and even when we were asking sort of 10 or 15 times what the same plant was, he would always tell us extremely patiently with just as much enthusiasm as he told us the first time, because we just couldn't remember. So I'd say no, absolutely not. Really don't be worried about that. The only important thing is that you've just got the interest there and that you're happy to be on a holiday that's dedicated to going in the pursuit of wildlife. But previous knowledge is not a prerequisite at all, and you won't be made to feel like it is by other members of the group. There'll be other people on the holiday as well who are in the same position, I'm sure.
Yeah, couldn't agree more.
Yeah, spot on.
Yeah. Steve, Simnet says, will all the locations and itineraries presented be in the new brochure? I think almost certainly.
Yeah,
I think they are all in there. Yeah.
Yeah.
If there are any tours that aren't in the brochure, then they are referenced in the sort of the intro page for each section. So at the start of the Europe page, there are some tours which aren't in the brochure but are on our website, and we'll give you the quick reference to, so you can look them up on the website. But I think all the ones we've spoken about
are
in the brochure.
Yeah. Brilliant. And if you
worth just adding to that, though, the brochure gives a really good overview, but there is much more detail on the website as well. So the website's the place to go if you want to download the detailed day-by-day tour itinerary or previous tour reports, of which for some tours there are loads of them. So you really get a really good feel for what you might actually be seeing and doing during the day. So do check that as well.
Absolutely. You can think of the brochure as the sort of shop window, and you can flick through lots of things, and then going on online onto the website is going into the shop and having a look at everything in more detail and flicking through everything. And of course, we're very happy to print things at the office and send it to you at home to read if you don't have a printer at home, but you want to read the itineraries in detail and don't want to do it on a screen. That's no problem at all. I think we've answered all of our questions.
I've just seen that Anne Holder's just said to us as panelists on the chat that the knowledgeable clients always help the others, and that is really true as well.
That is true.
Yeah.
Thank you,
Anne, that comment. In a nice, friendly, helpful way.
Yeah, absolutely. One thing that is a consistent comment that we have in feedback from Nature Trek groups is that you just end up with such a wonderful sense of camaraderie after the first couple of days of being on a trip together. You know, you're traveling together during the day, you're eating all of your meals together. You're sharing the experiences together in the evenings when you may sit down and talk about the excitement of the sightings that you've had over the day, be it that you're sitting in a yurt in the Arctic, or you're in the bar on a boat in the Maldives. You know, everyone sits around and you've got that shared enthusiasm, and everyone's saying, oh, did you see this? Did you see that? And, oh, I'll look forward to seeing that tomorrow. And everyone's showing each other their photos on their cameras and just sharing different experiences. And that's one reason why people say that they want to book on our holidays, is because they know they to get that sense of camaraderie and a lovely, friendly group atmosphere. So I think, thank you, Patricia, who's just messaged to say, very well done, team. That was fabulous. And my appetite is wet. That's good. That's great.
Thank you.
And Stuart Woolley says, sometimes a client's knowledge is a bigger help to the guide. for example,
geologist,
that's very true. You can have some world leading geologist on your tour, or a world leading botanist on a non-dedicated botany trip, for example. So it really varies, very much so, yeah. Okay, well, thank you all so much for joining us. This was the fifth of 13 evenings that we have, so please do sign up for others. You'll have a link sent to you in about 24 hours, which will send you a link through to the other presentations on our website. If you're not sure where they are, you can just look in that email. Some of you have requested more talks which cover our botany tours, so we are going to do those. Dates will be released soon, along with dates for more evenings. And we'd appreciate any feedback that you have. If you do want to email in and let us know how you enjoyed tonight or any thoughts you might have, then please do let us know. Just email us at info@naturetrek.co.uk. It's been so lovely each morning after we've done one of these presentation evenings to log on the next morning and just find so many kind emails in the inbox and people sharing their thoughts. So please do feel welcome to let us know. We read every single one of them, and it really means a lot to us. Finally, if you're in, if you're a member of a natural history club or society and you'd like us to do a talk to your members, we offer free talks to dedicated wildlife clubs and societies. So do just contact us to arrange it. We'll be very happy to do that for you. We'll be back the same time tomorrow evening at 7:30, where we're going to be going to South America for the second time, our second instalment. And we hope you can join us. We'll stay online for the next 5 minutes or so in case there are any last minute questions. But until next time, take care and good night, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone.